Remembered now for engraving what must never be forgotten. A modern thinker.
On your previous album, The Cave of Wondrous Voice, you set four poems of a tragic Russian woman poet of the Soviet era, Marina Tsvetaeva. With Trois, Femmes, you're introducing us to another fascinating figure from a later Soviet period, the film director Larisa Shepitko. Since both are relatively little known in the West, this would seem to indicate a serious interest in 20th century Russian history on your part.
For sure. It's an awfully complex and fraught history that Americans to this day are not very familiar with. Marina Tsvetaeva was a victim of Stalinist repression and killed herself in 1941. Larisa Shepitko was born in 1938. She was a prominent participant in the Soviet cultural world during the Brezhnev era of the 1970s. She left only a handful of works at the time of her death in a car crash in 1979. But one of them, The Ascent, is, in my view, probably the greatest single film ever made about World War II. To this day, few have seen it. The Ascent won the top prize at the Berlin International Film Festival in 1977, but Shepitko's death soon afterward relegated it and her to extreme obscurity in the West until Criterion Collection gave it a first release in 2008. I believe that if Shepitko had lived, she would have become an important force on the international scene.
What is particularly unique about The Ascent?
A number of things. It's set not on a well-known battlefield or a contested city like Stalingrad or Leningrad, but rather in rural Belarus during the brutal winter of 1942, when the epic and savage struggle between the Nazis and the Soviets could have gone either way. The film distills the horror and terror of the war by reducing its scope to the life of a village and its surroundings. Starving partisan fighters harass the Germans in the snow if they're able to stay alive. Innocent civilians are caught up in the occupiers' dragnet. The threat of death is everywhere, and the viewer feels it in an extraordinarily visceral way. You are there in a way that only the greatest of film directors can conjure. Shepitko's choice of characters and actors in this film are stunning. The martyred hero is gradually and eerily transformed into a Christ-like persona. His partisan sidekick betrays the cause to save his own skin. The Nazis' torture-dealing interrogator is not a German, but a breathtakingly corrupted Russian. A Belarusian farm widow is a hapless victim who musters the courage to go to her death with dignity. In addition, the black and white cinematography and screenplay are of the highest order. The Ascent is an absolute must-see.
The way you describe it, The Ascent seems to have avoided the propaganda leanings of many post-war Soviet films and achieved an artistic statement for the ages. That must have been a monumental task.
Larisa Shepitko paid a very high price to make this film. It took 4 years of intense struggle to receive official approval and financing. Her previous film, You and I, had met with numerous obstacles, including censors' deletion of several key scenes and her own physical near collapse. Despite her fragile health, Shepitko's integrity demanded that The Ascent be shot in the sub-zero winter conditions the viewer sees, and she suffered along with everyone else in the crew. But The Ascent was nearly banned upon completion. the authorities declared that a religious parable with a mystical tinge had been made instead of the patriotic partisan saga they expected. The film might never have been seen save for the intervention of Pyotr Masharov, first secretary of the Communist Party of Belarus, who himself was a partisan and whose mother had been executed by the Nazis in 1942 for aiding them. Masharov is mentioned in my Shepitko song in a line spoken by soprano Isabel Bayraktarian. At the very end of the piece, I quote a pair of short phrases from the Passacaglia movement of Dmitri Shostakovich's first violin concerto, written in 1947 and 48, and suppressed until after Stalin's death in 1953. The music's pathos seemed appropriate for wrapping up Shepitko's story.
Your realization of Trois Femmes is aided greatly by the contributions of Isabel Bayraktarian and pianist Carol Rosenberger, two musicians of the most distinguished pedigrees. They give committed and exemplary performances of a piece whose psychological depth requires just that.
Yes, I'm hugely indebted to both of them and also to producer recording engineer Matt Carr. Isabel and Carol were deeply touched by the piece right from the beginning and put a lot of hard and dedicated work into it. Trois Femmes is a journey of some length and quite a bit of intensity. I think it stretches the art song milieu close to its maximum acceptable dimensions, but doesn't exceed them. It helps if the listener has the curiosity to go beyond familiar texts by familiar poets, a device many art song composers resort to over and over again.